exercise offers, a stronger heart and a more toned frame. But that's only the beginning of the story. Dr. Bob Hariri joins us today, along with Dr. Jacob Wilson, to share with us amazing scientific studies that show that regular physical activity can turn back time. When you make activity part of your everyday life, your body starts to change at a molecular level. Even your DNA gets younger. So if you're looking for youthfulness, vitality, strength, energy, and a positive outlook, and want to maintain them all of your life, then you're at the right place at the right time. Get ready to drink from the well of activity, and welcome Dr. Jacob Wilson and Dr. Bob Hariri.
Much, everybody. It's outstanding to be here. It's a true honor. I'm excited here to be with Bob.
And I'm excited too. Are you guys excited? I thought so. I thought so.
So this morning we're going to talk about everything from what you can do now to optimize particularly your body composition, your muscle mass, lower your body fat is what I'm going to start to talk about. But there's limitations to what we can do today. But there's a future of technology, and that's what Bob's going to discuss. So to start off, I guess, like I said, we're going to talk particularly about body composition. But before that, I want to give a little bit of my story, my background. So for me, I've actually always been into science. Like, really, my parents didn't have a lot. My dad didn't have a lot. And since I was 5 years old, actually, my dad got me my first lab coat. So I started doing research all the way from then, all the way through school. And my dad told me education and science was a way to change the world. So that's how I was born, that's how I was brought up. And I knew, like, I went through school thinking this. And I got a number of degrees, on the topic. My BS was in nutrition. I got two masters, one in exercise physiology, one in psychology. And then my doctor was in skeletal muscle physiology. And I always thought that the more research you did, the more you published, the more you change lives. So it's the only thing, that's what I focused on. Let me do as many studies as humanly possible, because this information is going to get out to the general public. It's going to help change them. And so when I was doing my doctor, my dissertation was for my dad. I dedicated to my dad. So you want your dad to live forever. So my dissertation was on age-related muscle loss. And actually found some really cool things to prevent age-related muscle loss. And I kept going on after that, and I went into academics, and there was a big award, it was called Young Investigator of the Year Award, for an organization called NSCA. And I thought that if I had got that, I would have reached a pinnacle, and I must have changed a lot of lives at that point. So I kept publishing. I got over 200 publications, and I ended up getting told that I was going to get this award. And I thought it was going to be the greatest moment of my life. Literally the greatest moment of my life. And when I got the award, I looked at the audience. And everyone in the audience were doctors and PhDs and MDs. And instead of feeling excited, I actually felt down. I felt like actually let down. So I looked out in the audience and said, the only people who understand what I'm saying are these people in the audience. And the only people who understand any of these publications are them. It's not getting out to the real world. Now, Bob's been my good friend for a long time, like pretty much a decade. I've been doing research at Bob for over a decade, and he's been a friend and a mentor to me. And I talk to Bob about it and stuff like that. Sometimes I'm venting my frustrations, he'll help me. And Bob goes, and Bob's very straightforward, he goes, Jacob, listen. Like, you gotta take what you're doing and make it accessible to the whole population. Like, can't just be to scientists, it's gotta be something that you can take and package and make it possible to the whole population, which is one of the reasons why I'm so excited about this conference, is because that's the purpose of this conference, is to take science and reach everybody. So I talked a lot this about Bob and said, I'm going to just leave and I'm going to build my own lab, my own facility that's cool, that has high sex appeal, and that people could relate with. So that science is, I've seen publications that were 100 years ago that didn't get out to the population until now. I said, why is that to be the case? So what we did is we started this thing called ASPI, and we're partnered with Celularity. But I want to bring you to the lab and show you like some of the exciting things and what it looks like. So it's cool stuff. Thank you. So what we're gonna do is like a lot of the stuff that we do, we're focusing on body composition, health. I'm gonna give you four tips, cool tips that I think that you can take home and utilize like right now to optimize your body composition and health, okay? Then I'm gonna say, we all train hard, people work hard. You guys are clearly hardworking people because you're here on a Saturday, right? Most people are asleep. And I'm gonna talk about what limits us from reaching our goals physically, and then Bob's gonna talk about how do we use technology to break through that. Sound good? All right. So here's the thing. When you diet, like people, when you try and lose body fat, at first you might lose pounds very fast, but then what happens? You plateau. And what really happens, part of that is your metabolism goes from being good, right? Your metabolism goes from being high to what? To low. And it sucks. There was a study that recently came out that was from The Biggest Loser. Anyone ever watch that show? Okay, so they did a study on The Biggest Loser, and they took people and looked at them like several years later, right? It's like over 5 years after the show. What do you think happened to their body weight like 5 years later? Right back where it was. Yeah, right back where it was. But guess what happened to their metabolism? It was still low. Like 5 years after the show, their body fat came back, but their metabolism was still low. So this paper just came out last year. It's crazy, right? So what is it, what's one of the reasons why we are losing our metabolism? Do you think it's just fat that we're losing? We're losing muscle as well, and that's what they found. So basically what ends up happening is that, first off, our metabolism goes down and we yo-yo back up, and it drives us crazy. It drives us crazy. So it drives us crazy. We're losing muscle along with fat. So the biggest thing I always say for people who are dieting is you have to preserve muscle. You gotta be very careful with muscle, okay? Because as we diet, we lose muscle mass, and as we lose muscle mass, our metabolisms go down. So that's one of the first thing I'm talking about is you have to protect muscle when you're dieting. It's one of the first tips. Now, one of the things that people do when they diet, like one of my friends just got married, and I asked him, actually he got married a couple months ago, asked him, what'd you do? He looked leaner. He goes, well, I just did cardio. I didn't want to like bulk up or anything. I just did cardio, because that's how you lose fat. Have you ever heard that before? Just do cardio, lose fat. Why do people do this? Well, people do this because they think that, oh, if calories out is greater than calories in, we lose weight. They think it's that simple, right? So if I do more cardio, calories out is going to be greater than calories in, so I'll lose weight. But they're not thinking about what don't we want to lower? Muscle and therefore metabolism. Well, this study looked at guys just lifting weights, okay, and they looked at their metabolism. It did what? It went up. This is what happened when you did cardio alone. Metabolism went down. So if you're dieting and you're doing cardio purely, your metabolism is going to do what? It's going to go down. And you're going to have to do more cardio and more cardio and more cardio. Well, if you added weights to the cardio, metabolism actually went up. So first thing you have to understand is that, like, if you are trying to lose body fat, it's not just cardio. You have to do the combination of both, right? Because you have to defend your muscle in order to maintain your metabolism, or in order to prevent this yo-yo effect that we have. Does it make sense? So so the next question is, cardio is certainly important, but what type of cardio should you do? There's everything out there, elliptical, running, jogging, you know, cycling. What should we do? And actually, a large area that our labs research is what type of cardio you should do. One of the factors that comes into cardio is intensity. So a good friend of Bob and mine, and Bob's going to talk more about this when he takes over, a good friend of ours is Tony Robbins. Who knows Tony Robbins? Okay, pretty much everyone in the room, right? So so we measured Tony Robbins. Bob actually brought Tony into our lab, and we put him through everything. We had him on force plates. We analyzed his gait, his metabolism. And then we went out into the field and looked at him in his event, which is Unleash the Power Within. One of the most intense events I've ever been to, right? Anyone ever been to Unleash or seen it? It's unbelievable. Like, Tony's on there 15, 16 hours a day. It's unbelievable. So we measured him in the field to look at what happened, because he's clearly an extraordinary man. So here's what we found. Tony Robbins actually metabolized literally 8 to 10,000 calories a day at these events. Yeah. It's unbelievable. Jumps over 1,000 times and exerts over thousands and thousands and thousands of pounds of force he incurs on his body the whole day. Right? And people are just exhausted at this event, and then he's back on the next day. Like, people don't understand, if you look at what he does compared to, it's like the amount of calories you expend over 2.5 marathons, over 10 hockey practices. I know, because the same technology I use to measure him, we measure the Tampa Lightning, like, in their practices every day, so we know how many calories they're expending. So this is an extraordinary man, with an extraordinary amount of muscle, okay? So what would it equate to? Most people would be hospitalized if they did what Tony did on a daily basis. So we're actually doing a study now. We're going to look at the audience at his next event. But how does he burn so many calories? I'm going to show you the raw data. This is my favorite dog, a boxer. So how does he burn so many calories? This is the raw data at his event, okay? So every time you see this, that's a jump or an acceleration. So he's either running up the stairs, jumping up and down. So every time you see that, that's a jump or a high acceleration from Tony. So, and that's his heart rate. So if you were doing cardio, you ever do steady state cardio? You were just, okay, I'm just gonna cycle at 80 RPMs for 60 minutes straight. So what happens? Your heart rate stays steady, right? Okay, there's another type of cardio. That's steady state. What type of cardio does this look like? Interval training. So interval training is a way to expend a drastic amount of calories, and that's one of the reasons why we think Tony's going to be able to expend so many calories and why he's so lean, fit, and muscular. So, okay, so this is a little technique in our lab. We actually tested Tony on it, and he crushed it. This is me cycling in the lab. So you cycle all the way out. This weight drops. Like, it's actually brutal. Like, I've seen people throw up after 30 seconds several times. You pedal all the way out, a weight drops that you couldn't normally pedal without momentum. And then the computer reads. Anyway, so one thing you do is do all-out sprints. So think about it. When you weightlift, you almost go to failure at the end of the set. Do you know what I mean? But when we do sprints, we're just like, okay, cool, I did a sprint. And then you walk 10 seconds, okay, cool, I'll do another sprint. But you can also select sprints to where, like, I literally can't go anymore after 10 seconds, or I literally can't go anymore after 30 seconds. That would be hills, that would be you crank up the resistance on the bike, to where you're literally failing after 10 to 30 seconds. And I'm going to show you some data later where, like, those you basically do 4 to 10, 10 to 30 second sprints all out, where we found people lost a tremendous amount of body fat. And I'll show that to you in a second. And everything you do is walking plus sprinting or bounding. So for 10 to 20 minutes, so let's say like you do 30 second sprints or 10 second sprints, and then you do normal cycling for a minute. And then you do 30 second sprints, or you're walking around a track. And then every time you come back around the front, you sprint, right? Now the other thing is, it could be, it depends on your level of conditioning. What you want to do is look at your perceived exertion, say on a scale of 0 to 10. So for you, maybe an interval is, I'm going to walk very fast, and my perceived exertion is greater than 8 on a scale of 0 to 10 during those sprints. Okay? And then I come back down to maybe a 5. And that's the key. How impactful is it? Well, if you look at the treadmill when they say you, this is a study we did. If you look at the treadmill and they look at fat loss here, this is like the fat loss zone. We looked at a scale of intensity and fat loss. Look what happened when you're like near 100% intensity with fat loss. So the higher this is, the more fat you're losing. So it's telling you that like when you're on these, they're saying, oh, this is a fat loss zone. Like, no. Think about it for a second. Look at sprinters. What do they look like? Very lean, very muscular. Not any body fat on them. They're not doing long duration stuff. So these sprints, we've literally found that these 4 to 10, 10, 10 to 30 second all out sprints makes you extremely lean, and it's also not time consuming. So, you know, and I think, and a lot of you guys are have work, you're spending a lot of time with your families, it's quick and it works. And not just that, it works with your animals. So this is my cat Diego, is me interval training him. So I put Diego on a low-carb diet and started training him with the laser, and it worked. So, all right. So here's my next tip. You know, a lot of people have desk jobs. I work a lot. I mean, I do work a lot at a desk. And if you look at calorie expended at a desk when you're chair bound, it's not a lot. It's calories per day sitting at a desk. Okay. and then, but this is like yard work, and this is actually housekeeping here. So if you like if you're a mom and you're working with all your kids, taking them to soccer, cleaning the house, you spend a lot of calories in a given day, and then that's yard work. So if we're doing this all day long, what does it lead to? Right? So no, it's not good. So the thing is, a lot of people focus just on exercise. But it's the things we're doing not when we're exercising that count too. And there's this thing called NEAT, okay? It's a long term, it's called, anyone heard of NEAT? Okay, so many people, non-exercise activity induced thermogenesis. Okay, you're not gonna remember that, but the point is NEAT. Okay, it's basically, what is NEAT? It's spontaneous activity. It's spontaneous activity, okay? So some of you guys are kind of playing around with your hands, your feet are going like this. That's neat. And actually, studies show that people who are lean fidget a lot. They pace a lot. And people who are not, right? And there turns out there's a neat meter in our brain that people who actually, sometimes when they eat more, their neat meter goes off and they start fidgeting more. You ever see the person who can't sit still? You know, think about it. Everyone goes, like, when I'm an adult, they go, man, I used to have such a high metabolism when I was a kid. Look, anyone have kids? Okay. Look at your kids and see how much they stand still. They can't sit still. Like, you ever take your kid to church and they're sitting in the aisle? Right? How long can they stand still? It's like crazy. So what's really going on is they have a lot of need. So you can, things that we can do, we can take the stairs. During, actually, while you're at work, say, you know what? Every hour, I'm going to take a quick walk break. Okay? Fun with chores. I remember I was in grad school, I heard about this. And I was single, I was in grad school, and my house was a mess. And also, when I went to a lecture, I saw this, my house got clean. Because, like, okay, chores keep you lean, and then be creative at work. Get up, stretch, do things like that. And, of course, when you go to the grocery store, right, people circle around to try and get this spot. No, get in that spot. Okay? So that's key. That's neat. Okay? And then my last tip is basically, when you train, realize that we're incredibly adaptive creatures, okay? Human beings are amazing at adapting. So what happens is, one of the reasons why we stop making gains is because we stop innovating in our workouts, okay? And so when you go to the weight room, because I told you need to lift weights when you're dieting, there's a number of things you could change up. You can change up how heavy you're lifting in the gym. You can do light weights, you can do heavy weights. You can look at exercise order. Maybe you do leg press at the beginning and then you do lunges at the end. We'll start with lunges at the beginning and do leg press at the end. Okay? There's exercise selection. One of the things I always say, people are like, I can't make gains in my body. I go, okay, look at your workout routine. What do you normally do? Like, okay, well, I go in there, I do bench press, then I do cable flies, then I do the chest machine. And how long have you been doing that? 3 years. So I go, okay, every exercise you've done, stop doing them. And now do something you haven't done for a year. And also they start making gains. We found in our lab, exercise selection is one of the biggest things. Just changing that body composition changes are drastic. Change your training volume up. Sometimes do high volume, like a high amount of set, sometimes low. Change your rest periods. If you're resting 5 minutes, try resting 30 to 60 seconds. Okay? And repetition speed, you can change that up too. But these are all things. Look at what you're doing at each of these components and try and manipulate them. And if you're changing them constantly, at least every month, you'll keep making gains. But is there a limit to the gains that we can make? There is. So one of our interests, especially when I was back in graduate school, I was in a lab that focused primarily on what actually stopped us from making gains. Me, I was a normal responder to training, okay, moderate responder, but it was also very hard for me to make gains. And sometimes I went to the gym. You ever see someone goes to the gym and looks at a weight and their body changes, right? Like, I look at a pizza and my body changes. But with them, it's the opposite. I was like, why is that the case? And this is actually one of the things that got me interested in what Bob was doing, okay? So what we did, and this actually was one of my mentors, a lot of the research they were doing, they looked at people, they put them on a training program. Everyone got the same training program. Everyone had the same diet. And they found there were three major responses. There was this guy who trained for 16 weeks in the beginning and end, looked like this. Like, imagine training 16 weeks hard, and you look, some guys lost muscle. Like, I don't know about you, but if I trained 16 weeks and I lost muscle, I would be pissed off. Okay. So, but we saw that. Some guys made moderate gains, okay? Some guys were extreme responders. Insane amounts of gains in their muscle. Ridiculous. And we said, why? So you look directly at the muscle and things that are involved in muscle, what's in there? Well, it turns out inside of the muscle we have something called stem cells. Who's heard of stem cells? Okay. So very interesting topic, and Bob's at the forefront of this topic. Okay, so we looked at stem cells per 100 muscle cells. These are the people who are non-responders. The amount of stem cells they had in their muscle. Now, stem cells, Bob will talk to you more about them. But basically, they can increase muscle size, and they can turn to other cells and regenerate you. But non-responders were here. Extreme responders had a massive amount of stem cells. And those stem cells could be recruited and adapt and change the muscle and make it bigger. Stem cells were the life force of what allowed these people to be unique and adapt. And we think it's what makes athletes super athletes. But what about when we age? My dad always told me, he's like, you know what, Jake? He goes, Jacob, I could do everything you could do, but it takes me a week to recover. Okay? So we worked with Bob. We did a big study, and Bob will show some of that data, but we looked at every tissue in your body. But I'm going to show you basically here muscle tissue. So what happens when we age? We go here, we peak, and as we age, we lose our functionality. So we worked with Bob, and we looked at muscle stem cells throughout age. What do you think happened? They went down. It went down drastically. And so we saw older people couldn't gain muscle as fast. So this could be, this is depressing, right? But Bob next to me has the answer, and so I'm going to hand it off to him.
So first of all, I love listening to Jacob because he practices what he preaches. I found Jacob about 10 years ago when I was working, trying to understand what one of the untapped opportunities in healthcare might be. And believe it or not, the pharmaceutical industry has devoted 100 years to specializing in different areas, brain, kidney, heart, lung, etc. But the pharmaceutical company has basically ignored muscle as a target for therapeutics. The only people who paid attention to muscle were orthopedic surgeons, and as a neurosurgeon, we always thought orthopedic surgeons were glorified carpenters. But in fact, what they really are is they are probably the best experts in understanding what Jacob has just instructed you and taught you about. Muscle is perhaps your greatest defense against disease, and probably, and I'm going to try and convince you of this, probably one of the best ways for us to maximize our lifespan and our health span. Let me see if I can get, there we go. So, give you a little of my background. I'm a neurosurgeon by training. I'm an MD, PhD, who spent the first half of my professional life taking care of head and spinal cord injury. I was a guy who took care of patients at the absolute worst moment of their lives, and when we started to recognize that there was this very powerful biological tool that if we harnessed its activities, we might be able to turn back on nature's repair kit. And that's how I got interested, and my company was acquired by an emerging biotech giant, and in that company, we built the world's largest cellular medicine business. But aside from the fact that we're going after things like cancer and autoimmune disease, very, very serious diseases, over the last probably 5 to 10 years, in large part because of the relationship I built with Jacob, I've gotten very, very interested in how stem cells as a therapeutic platform might actually be able to influence how long we live and the quality of our lives as we live. Now, the good news about it is that today we are living far longer than our forefathers. Okay? If you actually look at the curve here for context, literally, lifespan in prehistoric times, the average age was about 20, 22 years of age. And then it slowly kind of crept up, and then literally since the 20th century, lifespan has begun to explode. And if you look for context in the United States, because our history is so compressed, you can see that we've literally approaching tripling lifespan since the American Revolution. And all of this is the result of breakthroughs in medicine and in healthcare-related areas like sanitation and so on, which has allowed us to eradicate causes of premature death and maximize the functionality of different systems like your cardiovascular system, like your brain. But here's the problem. That extra life that we're giving people comes with a price, because the longer we're living, the older population has to deal with chronic diseases, frailty, which is in large part the result of loss of muscle mass and cognitive decline, right? What's considered one of the biggest epidemics that faces us today? Dementia, okay? I'm gonna try and convince you that all these things, frailty, cardiovascular disease, and cognitive decline, may in fact be ameliorated by paying attention to your muscle. So if you think about it, since 80% of people over the age of 65 have at least one chronic disease, whether it be vascular, pulmonary, or cancer, okay, anything we can do to allow them to deal with those chronic illnesses and delay or arrest the progress of those diseases, those degenerative processes, will add quality to the extra years they live. Okay? If you just look at this statistic, by the time the population reaches 80, a third of people have significant cognitive decline that can be characterized as dementia. And if we're doing our job and we actually push life expectancy from 80 to 100, because part of the mantra we have today is to turn 100 into the new 60, look at those numbers. More than half the population, okay, more than half the population is over those years of age are going to have to suffer from dementia. That's something which is absolutely unsustainable and unacceptable. There was a dramatic effect of exercise and stressing your physiology on your general health, and that could all be monitored by looking at your muscle. And this maximum benefit, what we call the hormetic zone, is potentially a way for us to address muscle loss and allow us to maximize that organ system and use it to delay or arrest the progress of degenerative diseases. So the rate of physiologic changes in virtually every system is clearly related to age. And if you look here at everything from neurologic function to cardiopulmonary function, those declines are now predictable and are associated with the greatest loss of quality of life as we age. So the nice thing about it is it provides us a window of opportunity to employ what we call regenerative medicine strategies. Those of you in the audience who raised your hand that knew what stem cells were, stem cells are thought of as the principal biologic regenerative tool. Okay? And this is how I've spent the last 20 years developing the capabilities to turn living cells into medicines. Jacob kind of touched on this. What's a stem cell? A stem cell is a cell that retains the unique versatility to mature and specialize into any cell type of the body. Okay, stemness simply means you can become any specific part of the human body, brain cell, heart cell, etc. And that isn't one of my slides, but that's a fabulous picture. Okay. So I think we're missing some of the meat of the presentation. Do you guys want to try and put up the balance of it? But I'll keep talking. So stem cells are a tool which play a role in what I call the regenerative engine of your body. So everybody sitting in this audience, you're made up of a trillion cells. Each one of those cells winds up being replaced and renewed on a regular basis in your body. Okay? We undergo a process of demolition and renovation, and that entire process is driven by the population of stem cells you can find in every tissue organ of your body. Those cells are in pretty good shape in your body until you start to reach about midlife, sort of the 30s or the 40s. And then what happens is the reservoir of stem cells that are necessary to renew and renovate your body begin to be affected negatively, both quantity and quality. Let's see if we can, I think they're gonna fast forward for me all the way to where I was gonna get to? All right, so think about it this way. your ability to fight disease and your ability to maintain as youthful a form as you possibly can is totally dependent upon the population of stem cells that reside in your organs and tissues. So, years ago, when I was a neurosurgeon, I got to see this process. Okay, this is something called fetal surgery. Does anybody know what that is? So today, with great diagnostic techniques can be used during pregnancy, we can identify certain birth defects that are in development. And one of the birth defects that a neurosurgeon deals with is called spina bifida. Turns out spina bifida is when the spinal cord is exposed because the neural tube doesn't close. But if you know it early enough, you can open the womb, expose the fetus, literally close the skin back over the spinal cord, put the fetus back into the womb, close it up, and when you come back in 6 months when the baby is now fully developed, the baby is born without any evidence of a scar. It's profound, okay? Well, that got me thinking years ago, well, wait a second, how come that in utero environment creates infinite regenerative potential? And if that's biologically possible, could we somehow harness that and use it later on in life? So, I give my daughter credit. My daughter actually did a master's here at Georgetown after she got a biology degree at Princeton. And when she was in utero and I was a young surgeon, I ran down to the labor and delivery suite to look at the ultrasound that was being done in the first trimester. And it dawned on me for the first time that although she was a peanut-sized embryo, the placenta was already this big organ. When I was in medical school, they taught us the placenta was a vascular interface between the mother and the developing fetus. Well, I'm an engineer. I started my life as an engineer, as an aviator, before I went to medical school. So I think in pretty practical terms. And if in fact what they told me was true, the placenta and fetus would develop at exactly the same rate. The fact that the placenta was already this big organ suggested to me it was the rate limiter and the governor of embryogenesis and fetogenesis. And why would that be? I was hearing about stem cells. Suddenly this organ turns out to control the rate of development of the embryo. Is it possible that's where stem cells were produced? So on the basis of that early observation, I went looking. And talk about some of the crazy stuff Jacob's done in his life. I used to leave my laboratory at Cornell and sneak into the labor and delivery suite at 3 a.m. and steal placentas out of the waste bag. Okay? Everyone thought I lost my mind, okay? But what I was doing is I was taking these organs back to the laboratory and taking them apart. And what we found was that the placenta wasn't a vascular interface. It's a bioreactor. It's a stem cell factory. So at a time when everybody was saying the only place you were going to get stem cells were leftover embryos or abortus material, I found that we're throwing away, in this country alone, over 4 million placentas. Why not use that as the resource? So that discovery of placental stem cells changed the course of development of cellular medicine. So we're very, very fortunate now that we know enough about it that we have the most powerful cell therapy tool found in the waste deposit part of a hospital. Okay, so I said before that part of the mantra we have today in my company and in companies that are working in this field is we want to make 100 the new 60, okay? I know it's possible. I was just at a great conference out in California called the Visioneering Conference. It's a part of the XPRIZE. I don't know if any of you have heard of it. XPRIZE was founded by my kid brother, Peter Diamandis. And Peter basically has shown through his books Abundance and Bold and so on that anything is possible. The best way to predict the future is to create it yourself, right? So the way we approach this is to say, what is it that defeats us as we age? And if you look at this list of problems, low muscle mass happens to be at the top of the list because it's the easiest thing to deal with today. Every one of you can affect your muscle mass using the advice that Jacob gave you and very shortly by using some of the tools we can provide you with. Neurodegeneration, immune dysfunction, and let's face it, Do you want to maintain cognitive function and high performance mobility and not look good? Right? So looking good matters. Right? So all of these things are part of what we're doing to put added years into your lifespan, but also quality. So some of the work we were doing early on that got us to thinking that stem cells might be the answer is we were looking at treating a disease called epidermolysis bullosa. It's a terrible inherited skin disorder where baby's skin blisters and falls off. And in those studies where we were using stem cells, placental stem cells, to treat the disease, what we found was that those animals actually wound up living longer if they got an injection of these placental cells. Well, I called up Jacob and I said, you know what, we have to actually study this. So we went and we looked at it and we said, okay, what is it that a stem cell is delivering when you give it back therapeutically? And so here's a way I want you to think about it, okay? Residing in every cell in your body is biological software that's encoded in the DNA, okay? In every chromosome in your cell, you have basically software that's responsible for providing you the synthetic repertoire, all the proteins and other molecules that make up every component of your living being. Well, if that's true, then what's a stem cell? Think of a stem cell as a master boot disk, okay? It's like Microsoft Office, the whole program that you install into your computer resides in a stem cell. And the nice thing about stem cells is because you can collect them and you can store them away in cryopreservation, in suspended animation, that software never gets corrupted. So all of us sitting here, the stem cells in your body are continually being corrupted by things like viruses, chemical exposures, UV radiation. So even though you might have good stem cells as you're aging, the more they get exposed to those different injuries, the more damaged the DNA is, and the less effective that DNA can be used for producing all those molecules in your body. Well, if I have a stem cell that's in suspended animation, I can give it back to you. Then I'm using a master boot disk to reboot your system. So, about 15 years ago, a guy named McGonigal decided he was going to look at the relationship between the number of stem cells in your body and your age, and he found that there was a mathematical correlation that existed. I went and looked at this a little deeper and found that, in fact, this mathematical correlation was profound. You see, there's an exponential decline in the number of stem cells in your bone marrow as a function of age. If you look at a six-month-old baby, 1 in 20,000 cells in the bone marrow is a stem cell. If you look at an 80-year-old, it's 1 in 30 million. Okay? So doesn't that kind of make sense that, well, if it's a loss of stem cells, what if we just boost those numbers back up? So Jacob and I decided to look at this, and we did some studies where we said, okay, if it's in bone marrow, does it also occur in other organs and tissues? So here you see data from muscle and from brain and from bone, and sure enough, there is a profound decline in the number of stem cells that happens to correlate with function. So not only do you have a lower number of stem cells, but the lower number of stem cells is specifically related to declines in performance. So Jacob and I said, well, you know what, we're going to actually look at this. So we decided to collect stem cells from birth, from the placenta of some experimental animals, and give them back doses of those stem cells as they age. And lo and behold, we found out that something as simple as an intramuscular injection of their own stem cells from birth extended their lifespan 30 to 40%. Okay? And this was a rudimentary study. Since then, five different laboratories have confirmed this, but here's the nice thing about it. It represents one of the easiest ways to address age-related changes. Now, Jacob showed you some of the data from Tony Robbins. What you probably don't know is that Tony Robbins has embarked on a process of restoring his regenerative engine by getting doses of stem cells in order to treat his degenerative problems, joint disease and so on. And Jacob talked about the improvements that have been measured by his laboratory and his scientists in Tony's performance, both his muscular performance as well as his cardiovascular performance. All right, how does genetics play a role in all this, right? Okay, there's no doubt that genetics are important. Okay, there are clearly some genetic characteristics that are generally associated with longer and healthier lifespan. Although exceptional longevity, people who live to 100 and beyond, appears to have underlying genetic correlates, it's not the only way to get there. It's not the only way to live longer. Genomic analysis shows that genes are not the sole governor of whether or not you can live long enough, because so many things actually affect your genetics and your genomics. There are things like epigenetic effects, the results of your exposures to drugs, nutrition. But the bottom line is that if you want to look and see where you can't change your genetics right now. Maybe in the future we're going to be able to change your genetics with things like gene editing. But genetics only is responsible for roughly 20% of your longevity quotient. But there are things like your environment and diet, as Jacob pointed out. And when I talk about environment, I talk about the environment you expose yourself to, like exercise, that has the ability to impact 30 to 40% of your longevity. So let me tell you about an interesting study. There's an institute called the Karolinska Institute in Scandinavia that is like the Mayo Clinic of Europe. And you guys have heard of something called BMI, right? Everybody's obsessed with BMI. Oh, my BMI is too high, blah, blah, blah. So the Karolinska decided to study 9,000 men over a 25-year period, trying to link BMI to life expectancy, cancer risk, cardiovascular risk. Okay? What would you guys expect? Would you expect that BMI was directly predictive, right? Not at all. Not at all. It wasn't correlated at all to anything. Okay? It's just a way to make people feel insecure. Right? The truth is, you know what was predictive of lifespan and resistance to cancer? Muscle mass. Turns out, didn't matter how big you are, didn't matter what your weight was, didn't matter what your BMI was. If you maintain strength and muscle mass in your advanced years, you lived longer and you had a 40% lower chance of dying from cancer. Let's put this into perspective. If you were a smoker and you quit smoking, in 10 years, how much do you think you reduced your risk of dying from cancer? 30%. So muscle mass was better at keeping you alive and preventing you from dying from cancer than even quitting smoking. All right, so five modifiable factors that influence life expectancy, they're the ones you think about. Jacob touched on it. Fidget, okay? And you know, I know that Doro and the team here is gonna get you guys up off your feet in a little bit because I've gone on way too long, but moving around, getting away from a sedentary lifestyle is essential. Making sure that you control your blood pressure, that's an obvious one, but one of the best ways to control your blood pressure is to build your muscle mass. Muscle makes up 50% of the wet body mass of an average person's body. It means it's the largest venous capacitance organ in your body. And that means that it helps to control the hydrostatics, the hydraulics of your cardiovascular system. Muscle is important in blood pressure control. The probability of living really, really long, if you look at these factors, sedentary lifestyle is probably more influential than anything you could possibly imagine. And there are other things which obviously have a positive impact on longevity. These are not a surprise to anybody, but look at the last one, okay? Maintaining strength and muscle mass is essential to a healthy, long life. All right, so bottom line is, being a bit overweight but strong is not a bad thing, okay? It turns out, but staying strong is a commitment you all have to make. And Jacob pointed out, lifting weights, loading your muscle is essential to maintaining that muscle mass. Jogging, turns out that jogging is very, very important, but jogging by itself isn't the answer. You have to combine that cardiovascular performance exercise with muscle building. So, to kind of summarize all this, okay? The physioanatomic changes that occur in all of us as we age, so we morph from a youthful form to an aging form, reflects a change in the quality and quantity of your stem cells that are responsible for your regenerative engine. And one of the best ways we think in the future we're going to be able to impact your health as you age is to find a way to deliver back stem cells to restore that reservoir, that regenerative reservoir in your body. Okay? That's called recharging the regenerative engine. It does a lot of things to make sure that we're synthesizing all the right molecules, all the right proteins, all the right things that make up our structure and function. And most importantly, it allows the demolition process that goes on in response to inflammation to be countered by a renovation process driven by the stem cells. So, thank you very much. Enjoy talking.